Hello everyone, it's me Alex, and of course today is our Monday talk. I'm gonna give a few seconds for our followers and our students to join our live. I will be probably transferring to also my personal Facebook, and we're gonna keep learning. So what is new in trucking? Well, soon it's going to be lots of changes in weather, right? Winter storms, we need to pay attention to different things. First, we need to make sure that we really calculate the transit, our HOS. We need to make sure that we know roads and interstates, and sometimes we are not gonna book the load just because we need to make sure that our drivers stay safe, right? No money is worth of somebody's life. So as a new dispatcher, you need to learn that. And again, hopefully we're gonna have some followers and some students, and I will be answering the questions as well. What else is new? We had a very productive weekend because we had what? We had our second dispatch class for our October students. We have 40 students in the class. Everybody is putting lots of effort. I am very pleased with their feedback, with finishing homeworks, with most of them being interactive in the class. That's why we guys different, because our classes are not pre-recorded. Like you see me right now, that's how you see me during the class. It's 4.5 to 5 hours. Yes, sometimes it takes us longer because we want to make sure that all of you are understanding the process, that all of you are determined, all of you know what you want to achieve. But let's go to the basics. We have lots of people following us from all over the world because, as many of you know, dispatch is probably 60% right now, 65% is outsourced, outside of the country. We have people in Asia, Central Asia. We have people in Eastern Europe. We have people in Central America who are supporting logistics on both ends for carriers and brokers as well. We have the full calling centers, and some of them are doing a good job, and some of them are lacking some knowledge. So why is it challenging to start and become a good dispatcher? Because it's a lot of things involved. But let's think, what are the first things you need to know? USA is a huge country, right? Don't you think that we should start by knowing our time zones? Look at this. You, as a new dispatcher, have to understand that we have more time zones, but in trucking industry, you guys gonna be worried about Eastern, Central, Mountain, and Pacific. Why is it so important? Well, this is important because when you're talking to the broker and you're listening to the transit, especially, look at this, when you guys are in between zones, let's say Illinois and Indiana, Alabama and Georgia, Kansas and Colorado, Nebraska and South Dakota, Nevada and Utah. Sometimes you can be only 30, 20 miles bordering those states, but it's a different time zone, right? So let's practice. I hope I will see other people joining us and asking questions. So Eastern time. So we started right now, 6 p.m. I am in Chicago. So I am right here in Illinois, right? So I am in Central zone. So if it's 6 p.m. right now in Chicago, then let's say I have students in Maryland. I have previous students in New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, North Carolina. I have lots of students from Florida. So what time is it right now then in Florida? If this is a 6 p.m. in Chicago, well, of course, they're going to be hour ahead, right? So that means that it's already 7 p.m. Well, let's look further. Now I have some students from Colorado. I have people in Idaho. I have people from Arizona. Never had no one from Montana or New Mexico yet. Although no, I am mistaken. I did have a student from New Mexico, Albuquerque. So what time is it there now? This is a mountain time. So if I have 6 p.m. right now in Chicago, 6:06, it's going to be what? 1 hour behind, right? So they are at 5:05 p.m. And of course, I have a lot of people on the West Coast, California, Washington, Oregon. So what time is it there right now? They are 2 hours behind. So if I am at 6, they are going to be at 4 p.m. This is basics that any dispatcher, any driver, any safety personnel has to know. So again, let's repeat. We have 4 zones on continental USA because it's USA has more zones because we have Alaska, we have Hawaii, we have Puerto Rico. We're not talking about that. We are talking about continental USA because, as many of you know, how many states are you guys going to be traveling to? Well, how many? Sometimes I hear 50, sometimes I hear 51, sometimes I hear 46, but it's 48 states where your truck can go and pick up load or deliver load. So 48. Let's remember that. We're not swimming to Alaska unless we have Canadian authority and we're going to go through Canada. We're not swimming on a truck to Hawaii, right? So yes, USA has more states, but in trucking, we are concentrating on 48 states. Let's see. We have some my previous student. Hi, dear Alex. Your knowledge is the best. An example knowledge for all truck dispatcher. Yes, honey. And you were such a good student. I love my students still watching us and supporting us. So let's say hi to everybody. Hello, hello, everybody from different countries, different backgrounds. What is our next class? Our next class is going to start November 13th. Make sure you guys sign up and sign up earlier because you need to get ready for my classes. But we're going to continue with some basic knowledge, right? Because today we're going to be answering basic questions. So now all of you are good on what? On time zones, right? Now we need to make sure that we know the regions. Why is it important to understand the regions? I've been working today in all the classes over weekend because markets are different. And sometimes you're going to be working with the carriers who only do regional runs. So let's see. This is not as detailed regions. And I will follow with more details a little bit later after this slide. So Northeast region, Southeast region, Midwest, Southwest region, Rocky Mountain region, and Pacific West Coast. But since you guys want to be a pro, I want you to know this in details. So we're going to be dividing by operating area, right? And as many of you know, you need to know your states. So first, we're going to divide by Northeast. So which states are going to the Northeast? Maine, Vermont, New Hampshire, Massachusetts, New York, Connecticut, Rhode Island, Pennsylvania, New Jersey. So this is the Northeast. Okay? And right now, please, do not concentrate on zones by that. So Northeast region. We're not talking about right now Z0, Z2, Z3, Z5, because that's how power that divides them. Right now, we're just going through operating areas. So Northeast. Then we have Mid-Atlantic. So which states are going to mid-Atlantic? Maryland, Delaware, Virginia, of course, District of Columbia, and West Virginia. Then, guys, just picture map in front of you. You're going to southeast. And we're going to include Kentucky, Tennessee, North Carolina, South Carolina, Georgia, Florida, Alabama, and Mississippi. Southeast, right? After that, we're going to be moving forward with middle part of USA. So let's start with southeast. Since we finish in Florida, we're going to take over this way. So southeast is South Carolina. Oh, hold on. We already covered southeast. This is the same slide. No. So we're going to go to Midwest. Midwest. Michigan, Ohio, right? Illinois, I am in Midwest. Indiana, Missouri, Iowa, Wisconsin. Midwest is a very strong area for any type of trailers, right? Because why? My students already know, because we have lots of production, lots of processing facilities, distribution centers, and of course we have land to build those factories, right? We also have lots of people living on the Midwest, and we have space to build those distribution centers, to have that craft facility, to have that AmeriColds, right? To have those factories in Indiana or Tennessee. And we're going to be moving to central area, which most of us, we consider it as beginning of Midwest and going to the mountains. But still, in most of the stuff, it's considered as Midwest. Minnesota, North Dakota, South, and Nebraska. And then we're going down, and it's going to be Central South. It is South because usually, you know what, guys? They don't really have snow. They have a nice weather. So they are Central South. Kansas, Arkansas, Louisiana, Oklahoma, and Texas. And now we're going to Southwest. So which states are going to be Southwest? New Mexico, Arizona. And we are moving to mountains. Utah, Colorado, Wyoming, Montana. Well, Utah, Colorado are good states. We still have some commodities. We usually take loads there. Pay attention to Wyoming and Montana. First, to the weather. Secondary, it's not that many people living there. So what does it mean? That means that it's not going to be much production there. That means that we are going to just certain cities, not many of them. So if you're going to be talking about Wyoming, it's probably Cheyenne, Wyoming. If you're talking about Montana, probably Billings, Montana, maybe Helena, Montana. Not that many cities. Even if you're going to look at the map, you don't see much going on there. And we're going to Pacific. Oregon, Washington, Idaho, right? So now we know USA by regions. As a beginner dispatcher or dispatcher who started already working, is that something you should really, really know? Yes, this is the basics. This is like a kindergarten, right? Kindergarten of dispatch. Okay. Let's see who is joining us. Hi, Alex. Hello, guys. Really good training. Sign up. Thank you. Heard the mountains isn't fun for fuel. Again, why not? Why it's not fun for fuel? You're going up and down, especially if you are heavy, right? You using more fuel. That's first of all. Secondary, what about your brakes? So as a dispatcher, don't you need to pay attention not to the only zones and time, but also what kind of landscape is there, right? Is this a mountains or it's just an open fields like in Wisconsin, right? Or Illinois, which is like, you know, prairie. But you go to North Carolina, you go to Pennsylvania, we have mountains. You go to West Virginia, you go to Virginia, you go to Colorado, you go to Wyoming, you go to Montana, you go to Washington. Wow, it affects your fuel usage. It affects how good is your driver is, right? And you need to pay attention to what? To weight of your loads, right? Heavy loads. Hi, Alex. Great training session yesterday. Thank you. Thank you, Tony. Minnesota. What about Minnesota? Minnesota is a great state. We all gonna divide Minnesota, upstate Minnesota, central Minnesota, right? Lots of commodities for all types of trailers. Love Minnesota, especially for reefer trailers, for flatbed step decks, or people who crossing going to Canada, right? Heavy loads, burn my fuel, and wear tier on equipment. Yes, that's what we need to know. So let's continue. Somebody's asking us how to open MC number. Well, seems like a young kid wants already to open MC. So what is MC? Well, MC is a motor carrier number, right? This is a number that allows you to cross state lines, right? That means that you have at least one truck, one CDL driver, and you are willing to become a carrier. How to open MC? That's very easy. You're gonna go and file with a Federal Motor Carrier Administration. It's only cost you $300, but that would be so easy, right? Everybody would have MC. I guess it's not just about $300, right? So what else do you need? You will need to file insurance, right? You need to make sure that you have a primary liability on file. And let's see our requirements. So it's $750,000 if you want to activate MC. And plus, you need to file BOC3 filing, blanket of coverage. In our class, we go through all the steps. Can anyone open MC? Guys, anybody can go pay $300, but that doesn't mean that MC is going to be active. One more time, to get that MC active, you need to follow two steps. File the insurance, liability insurance on file with FMCSA, Federal Motor Carrier Safety Administration. Minimum requirement is $750,000 and BOC3 form. And we're going again to question with people asking me over and over and over. Does dispatcher has to have an MC? Guys, hopefully, I'm not screaming, but hopefully you can hear me really, really clear. If you just a dispatcher, you do not need MC. You do not need an insurance, liability insurance. Why? Because you will be providing service for motor carrier. Who has that? They have to go through those steps to activate MCs. Let's go back, and some people are still confused between what does it mean, and as a new dispatcher, when you answering the questions in setup packages, or you talking to your carriers and you asking them, what kind of carrier are you? You need to understand that we have two types of carriers, interstate carrier and intrastate carrier. So interstate carrier is crossing the lines. For example, you are in Tennessee. If you decide to go to Georgia, if you decide to go to Kentucky, if you want to go to Indiana, you crossing the state's borderlines. You need to apply for motor carrier MC, interstate. Let's say you are a trucking company who also in Tennessee, but who is only gonna stay in Tennessee. In this case, you are intrastate carrier, only in Tennessee. Do you need to apply for motor carrier MC? No, you okay to operate with only US DOT number. That's why you see sometimes that people have MC, US DOT, and another one, ICC number. And ICC number, this is intrastate carrier, common carrier number, which you're getting from your state. Let's answer a few more questions. So another thing you need to know as a new dispatcher, are you a common carrier or you are contract carrier? So guys, if you're working for trucking company, usually this is a common carrier, right? Common carriers provide trucks for hire. Somebody's hiring us to move product from A to B. Freight from Chicago to Memphis. Freight from Memphis to Miami. Of course, they're going to compensate us, right? They pay. So that's why we are common motor carrier for hire. So who is contract carriers? Well, those are also for hire truck of transportation, but they work for specific individual shippers based on a contract. Or they might be a military contract carriers, right? Or maybe for government. So make sure you know the difference. And biggest difference that contract carriers must file only liability, right? Bodily injured and property damage with FMCSA. What else? Who are the exempt carrier? Well, exempt carrier is a transport agency specializing in services such as taxi services, limo services, maybe some bus services, or specific commodities. For example, maybe farm products or the bulk cargo, right? So they are exempt from regulations by the Interstate Commerce Act. That's what means when they're asking you, are you exempt carrier? So guys, if you do not deal with a farm product or bulk cargo, or you're not a taxi service, or you're not a limo service, well, you are not exempt carrier. You are common carrier for hire. Are we clear on this? That's what you need to know. As a dispatcher, you need to know who is in charge of all the rules and regulations. So please memorize it. Federal Motor Carrier Safety Administration, right? They are govern us on federal level, right? They are giving us MC. They are creating all the regulations, for example, hours of service, right? And then we have a state administration, United States Department of Transportation, in Indiana, in Illinois, in Montana, in Nebraska, all 48 states, right? So besides that, we have some things which are handled by what? By another branch, Federal Highway Administration. Let me all answer a few questions and then we're going to continue. So, okay. What is the best way to learn how to read HOS log? Well, the best way to read HOS log is to know what? The rules, HOS rules. So let's look really fast. We know that we had a new updates, right? We had some things change since last September. We had short haul exception added. We had adverse driving condition change. We had some changes with 30-minute breaks. We have changes with, let me close this so it's bigger. with sleeper berth provision, right? So let's see really fast for people who are new. What is HOS? Can we please memorize that this is hours of service for whom? Who is regulated by this? Am I regulated as dispatcher? No, but as a dispatcher, I need to know the rules. I need to make sure I know how to read the logs. I need to know how to schedule transit, right? And when the broker tells me pickup is at 5 p.m. and we have a strict delivery 7 o'clock next day, well, we're not a Boeing, we're not flying. You need to understand miles. You need to understand the rules. And we're going to go through some of them. So for brand new people, we have something called cycle, right? Consider it like your working week. Like you work from Monday to Friday, right? Most of the people work from Monday to Friday. Usually you work what? 8 hours, right? You work 8 hours, it depends on the state. They have to make sure that you have mandatory break, right? I don't know, 45 minutes, 15 minutes. You know what, guys? Don't really know those rules because I never work for nobody. So I am in charge of my own breaks. I'm in charge of my own holidays. I am in charge of planning my own schedule. Don't really follow the regulation, labor department regulation if you are working for someone, right? But we're not talking about this. We're talking about rules for our drivers. So cycle, this is kind of working week, right? And we can have 70 or 80 hours within what? 7 to 8 days. It depends on company policy. When you finish working, usually, guys, what do you have? You have weekend, right? You don't work Saturday, Sunday. You have 2 days off. Nowadays, with this economy, I think we all work in 24/7. We don't really have Saturday, Sunday off. I personally don't have it because I teach classes. Not because I really have to work that much, just because I am a workaholic. Okay, not a good thing, guys. Don't be like me. Just make sure you plan your time. So driver has 70 hours. After he uses those 70 hours, FMCSA set the rule. Mia, they said, well, you need to do restart. For how long? 34 hours. 34 hours. You cannot keep driving. You cannot go driving towards the next load. You cannot operate commercial vehicle, right? Then 34 hours is going to end and you start in a new cycle, right? So as a dispatcher, do we need to pay attention to this? Yes, we do. So this is our working week. Now let's go to the rules every day. Every day we have a shift. We have 14-hour shift from which driver can only drive 11 hours. So now let's think logically. If he is not loading, unloading, and he got loaded yesterday and today he's just driving, let's think about average speed for the trucks. Well, it can go from 55 in California, it can go to 70, 75 somewhere in Montana. So let's average it to 62 per mile. So if you can drive 11 hours, 62 per hour, magically, in a perfect condition, you can drive 620 miles a day. Happens? Not really, because you will go through the traffic. You still have to have a break. You still need to fuel, right? So that's how you're going to calculate. So when I look at the transit, I know that realistically with loading, unloading and everything else, it's not going to be 630 miles. This is going to be less. So you need to make sure that you know this. Okay? So let's look what change from previous rules. Let me share the screen. Okay, Let's see. So let's look at this. Okay. So now they increase that short haul exception, right? It used to be only 100 miles. Now it's 150 miles. But you need to understand that they still have some stipulation. You need to start and end shift in the same location. So this is something which works for the local drivers, right? And we need to make sure we understand this. What's going to be next rule that they change? Let's see. Okay. Next one, HOS changes, no violations, adverse driving condition exceptions, 30 minutes break, sleeper berth provision. So let's look at this quote. So previous time, we had drive up to 2 hours beyond the driving limits, right? Now they change it, extension. It applies to both driving limit and on duty. So instead of 11 hours drives and 14 hour driving window, now we are adding, right? So look at this. When we have adverse conditions, we can drive for 13 hours and our shift is becoming 16 hours. Are we clear on this, right? So this is something new, which came in place in September, I believe 28th or 29th of the last year. Let's see what else. You need to understand what is adverse conditions, right? Can be adverse condition every time you decide, like, choose it? No, they have very specific. It can be snow. It can be traffic, unusual traffic. It can be maybe accident or hurricane or something. So you need to make sure you know this. And guys, if you want to receive this, you can go to FMCSA and look for HOS hours, or you can drop your emails or subscribe and send me a message and I will share this with you, because you really need to understand this. Then they change something about what? About the break, right? So previously, the 30 minutes required break was only satisfied of off-duty, right? Now they said that you can do it off-duty in sleep and berth, on-duty, but still not driving. So this the big change that they change. And guys, we have here example violation, not violation. My students will be receiving HOS hours today. But the biggest change was that they added the sleeping berth provision. So what does it mean? We could split our sleeping period, which supposed to be 10 hours. So for new students, let me repeat. Driver has 14-hour shift. After he's done, from this 14 hours, he can drive only 11 hours. And then mandatory, he has to sleep for 10 hours. Mandatory. Whoever made these rules, I don't know what they were thinking about, because personally, all Americans, whoever working, we don't have that 10-hour mandatory sleep. And I know that drivers, for some of them, it's even hard to use it as for the sleep. So they usually sleep 6, 7, 8 hours and they good to go. So this is something which we need to bring up to government, and hopefully one day it's going to be changed. But I do believe that it's nonsense. Okay. But can I change it? Not really. I don't really work for FMCSA, and just nobody going to hear just me. Hopefully all of us together, maybe we can change this for better. So HOS, right? Hours of service. What else do you need to know as a dispatcher? We have a bunch of different certifications, right? when you guys gonna be finishing up setups, a lot of times you will need to answer the questions. Do you have CTRAD certification? Do you have the TWIC certification? Are you a hazmat carrier? Do you have a safety permit, right? Do you have the FAST certification? Are you a part of the SmartWay certification? So all of this is a different certifications which carrier might have. Then they're going to ask you about some certification as for business. For example, small business certification or minority-owned business enterprise. So if you are part of this, you have to make sure you have that certificate available. And as a dispatcher, you're going to answer those questions. But at least understand what does it mean, you know, AMWBE. And nowadays, guys, it's no excuse because you can just Google this stuff, right? What else do we need to know as a new dispatcher? Don't we need to know equipment types? Look how many different equipment we have in USA. I don't know, starting with Conestogas, containers, specialty equipment, right? We have flatbeds, maxi, dubber, air ride, chain, sides, tarps. Why do you need to know this? Look about the van, air ride, Conestoga, van double, insulated, logistic. That's the posting. That's how you're going to be posting on your load board, right? Reefer, right? Reefer with a team, straight box, tanker, van, all of this, guys, you need to learn. You need to know your equipment if you want to succeed. We have been covering this on our second class, right? Besides knowing equipment, you need to know the legal weight, right? So what is the legal weight in USA for our truck, trailer, and cargo? Well, it's 80,000, right? 80,000 total weight with cargo, truck, and trailer. What do you need to do before you're going to dispatch? You need to know empty scale ticket, right? Every dispatcher has to know the empty scale ticket exactly for this truck and exactly for this trailer with the full fuel tanks, right? So you're going to ask your drivers, hey, Mike, hey, Steven, hey, Paul, hey, Andrew, hey, Alex, hey, Vasil, hey, whoever your driver is, please, can you provide me with empty scale ticket? Why? Because as a dispatcher, you need to know the maximum weight of product can go on this combination. So knowing your equipment, knowing HOS, knowing certification, this is the basics. This is the basics before you want to pick up that phone and start looking for carriers. Let's see, and we're going to answer some questions. Need to be registered with a, does DBA needs to be registered with a secretary? Okay. Who is this? Thank you so much for answer. I appreciate your work. I'm always recommending your dispatch classes. Thank you. Guys, let's answer some questions because I know that some of you are confused about something. So let's see. We have Nadezhda. Understanding HOS is the main thing for dispatcher. If you don't want to hear complaints from drivers, not just drivers, because if you don't know HOS, what's going to happen? You're going to be booking loads, which is going to be impossible to deliver. So that means that you put in carrier in violation of HOS, or you're not going to be delivering or picking up on time. So you're losing partnership, and the worst things can happen when you have a cargo on your trailer and you miscalculated your hours, and now the guy has to sit somewhere with minus 10 degree, because I know that Nadezhda is in charge of reefers, right? And wait for 34 hours, right? Not smart decision. So also, what else? What other question? 80,000, right? on each trailer units. Can we separate legal waste on each trailer units, Alex? What do you mean by that? Well, we have total weight, which is legal, 80,000. Besides the total weight, we need to make sure that we not overweight on axles. So just picture, cut it in the middle, 34,000, 34,000. And right now I'm talking, for example, about 53-foot trailer, but doesn't matter. You cannot go over 80. Sometimes drivers say, well, my load is only 39,000. Yeah, I'm not overweight. Well, he's not going to be overweight on 80,000, but he might be overweight on his axle. So we need to make sure you guys understand this. Okay? So what else going on? Let's see. Before you guys going to start booking, you need to understand we have total trip miles, right? If we are delivering somewhere, who is this? In Madison, Wisconsin. This is our destination for delivery. Let's say it's Kroger. So who is Kroger? Is receiver. Then you as a dispatcher, you book in your truck and you driving empty to Chicago, Illinois. Now you're picking up an Americold. So in this case, Kroger was receiver because you deliver your goods there. Americold is in Chicago is shipper. You're going to Boston, Massachusetts, maybe also to Americold, but the Boston Americold now becomes receiver. So we need to make sure you guys know your terminology, right? We have origin of the load. That's where we're picking up. That's going to be Chicago. We have our destination of the load, right? So when you call the broker, do you think the broker knows where you're delivering? That's why you need to make sure you know how to calculate your deadhead and how long is it going to take you, right? How long is it going to take you to get to Chicago? How many hours are you going to use from that shift today? And how many more hours do you need? But remember, the miles on a Google Maps, it's just a distance. Does Google Maps knows the rules of FMCSA? So that's why you have to predict. In this case, we are talking about Madison to Chicago, probably, let's say, 90 miles. Chicago to Boston, 990 approximately. It depends where in Chicago, where in Boston. So we have total of 1,080 miles or maybe 1,100. That's a total miles. But what is the transit? Look here. Transit, we are measuring in days and hours. It can be too long. It can be too short. It can be impossible, right? So let's think about it. Today is Monday. You were delivering in Madison. You called about the load in Chicago going to Boston. Broker's telling you, well, it's picking up at 12 o'clock. Hopefully you are delivering early. You're going to be able to pick up. And they are telling you, this is going to deliver tomorrow at 4 p.m. If you have a single driver, can you make this transit? Google Maps going to show you so many hours of driving, right? No, you cannot. Because after your driver is going to get loaded, probably he gets somewhere to Ohio. And what's going to happen? He has to sleep for 10 hours, right? Then he has to start his day with a PTI and everything else. Then he's going to continue. So realistically, if he gets loaded really fast in Chicago, he can be there really late at night. So when they are telling you delivery, it has to be Wednesday morning, unless you have a team. But still, if you have two drivers, you still need to understand how long is it going to take loading, how long it takes them unloading, what is deadhead, right? And who is going to be driving first, then the other person takes over. So probably for the team, yeah, they can make it afternoon. So this is a transit in hours. So in this case, a realistic transit picking up on Monday, delivery Wednesday morning. What if you book in the load and they are telling you, well, pickup is on Monday and you're going to be delivering in Boston on Thursday night? Is that a good transit? No, this is ridiculously long. Doesn't make sense. Are you going to be losing Wednesday and Thursday? No, you're not. You're not going to be sitting with commodities there. Your driver needs to keep going and make money, right? So HOS, understanding the distance, understanding how it works is very important. In classes, we're going to be practicing over and over and over, right? Plus, yes, somebody said, then we have all the adverse driving, right? Due to construction, due to unforeseen issues, due to accidents. And right now, what's going to happen? Winter's coming. How many accidents, how many snowstorms are we going to have? Lots, especially if we are looking at this route, Chicago to Boston. Believe me, going through Ohio, going to Pennsylvania, sometimes it's nightmare. It's easier. It's easier to go through Montana and sometimes Wyoming than going through Pennsylvania in the winter snowstorms, right? Because when they have accidents, they stop there for hours and hours and hours. Why? Because of congestion. So many truck drivers are on East Coast. Plus, let's be realistic, most of the drivers who are driving those crazy Volvos, they don't even pay attention. They just go cut each other off and they just keep going, right? Because they don't have government on their truck. So they go 77, 80, winter happens, right? Black ice or something. Boom, the first truck hits somebody or maybe a car in front of you. That's why we see 20, 30, 40, sometimes even 80 vehicles involved in accident because of the speeding, because of the winter condition, and because drivers, when they go on East Coast, it's not that many weight stations, so they actually do take advantage of that. Not really proud of drivers who do that because, again, what are you doing? You're putting somebody's life in risk, and it's not worth it. It's not worth it. Nobody deserves to die just because you're speeding with 80,000 on the weight, trying to go in front of each other. I've seen it so many times. I hear the story. I know what the drivers do. So please, dear drivers, remember that it can be somebody's mom. It can be somebody's dad. It's your kids. It can be your own family who can get involved. So slow down. Winter is coming. Please slow down. What else? We need to make sure that we understand all this. And we're going to go. We understand already what is the empty miles, what is the loaded miles, and total miles. As a dispatcher, as a good dispatcher, we always going to calculate rate per mile for total miles. So total miles include empty miles and loaded miles. So how much are we getting paid? Nadezhda, how much are we getting paid for deadhead, for empty miles, huh? How much should we charge them? Are we charging them $2 per mile? Are we charging them $3 per mile? When do we ask them to pay us for deadhead? Well, guys, they don't really care about your deadhead. They are not really paying for your deadhead unless they really need your truck and your truck is further than 50 miles and it's 100, 150 miles. How important are the steps? Well, you need to pause the truck. Before you pause the truck, what are you going to do? Well, you're going to look at what? At deadhead, right? You're going to look at deadhead. Let me just adjust my light a little bit. You're going to look at deadhead. You're going to make sure that your driver has enough hours to make this transit, right? Does he have enough hours for today? Does he have enough hours for tomorrow? Does he have enough hours to finish this transit? Or maybe you cannot take the load all the way to Boston. You only have 16 hours cycle. So before it was this rock, make sure you check LB. And most of my students have a problem. They start the session and come all the operators, they say, well, don't worry, but you don't need to look at my ELD. Guys, if you are not having access to ELD, you will never become a pro. You will make mistake after mistake after mistake. Because while you're talking and you're looking at hours and you're looking at your map, you need to calculate. You cannot keep texting your driver. You cannot book the load and then ask the driver, do you think we can make this transit, right? That's not a smart booking. So please make sure that you have access. You're going to post the truck. You're going to call about posted load, right? And you need to ask same questions over and over and over and over. So let's see. Let me see if I can log in to that power, truck stop, or whatever load board. So we're going to post the truck, right? We're going to post the truck, let's say even for today, right? What are we going to post? I don't know. I'm in Chicago, right? Destination. Do I know the plan for my truck? The good dispatcher always going to have a plan, right? Maybe this guy only stays on Midwest. So I'm going to put Z4, Z5, Z6, Z7, right? Maybe he just got unloaded, or maybe my load got canceled, but he's ready to go. Can I put it in comments? Ready to go. So let's post, right? You can put your name. You can put what he has, because if you know your equipment, you know that he has, for example, E-tracks to secure the load. You know that he's a tanker endorsed, endorsed driver. You know that he has swing doors, and you know that he has maybe wooden floors, right? Okay, let's post. What did we miss? Remember, every equipment's gonna have a different maximum weight. Well, oops, I made mistake. I didn't pay attention. What I'm gonna do, I'm gonna go add it, because I'm always gonna put maximum weight. And the maximum weight for driving is always going to be 46,000. I want to stress this out for people who are working outside of the country. Because lots of times, you are getting bossed around by the owner operators, and they are telling you what to do, how to do, and they telling you, oh, you know, Mike, or Harry, or Bruce Willis, because you guys use those nonsense names, all the famous names, right? James Bonds, everybody's James Bond and outside dispatching services, which is kind of funny. But let's say James Bond, make sure that you do not book for me loads that are heavy loads. So you, as a responsible guy, what are you doing? You posting 25,000, right? So let's see the difference. Right now I have 554 exact matches. That exactly for today, exactly for driving. If you're going to be listening to your owner operator and you're going to post 20,000, right? What's going to happen? Now you're only looking at 131 loads, right? So 554 and 131, it's a big game changer, right? Do you agree? I think that's something you don't really want to do. Okay, let's add it back. So always put maximum. You want to see all the loads. You know why? A lot of times the weight is not displayed correct. And I can tell you this. I already know statistics. 80% of the brokers do not post correct weight. This is a bummer, but that's what's happening. So when I told you organize by the deadhead, that's what we're doing in our classes. This is the loads I want to call first, right? Because look at this, zero deadheads. If I wanted to check the highest paying loads, well, where is it going? All the way to Texas. Does it mean that it's a best paying load? No, because you still have to pay attention to the miles, right? Just because it's 3,600 doesn't mean that it's a best load. So how comfortable do you have to get with posting, deleting, copy, or you want to have a different plan for him? Because instead of the Midwest, he can also go maybe south. You want to have an extra posting. So what are you going to change? Well, maybe you're going to put here Florida, Georgia, and Alabama. You can do it by states, right? Now you have two postings for the same truck, two different plans. Plan A is to stay on Midwest. Plan B, if he's going to go south, it can be only Georgia, Florida, and in this case, Alabama, right? What about all these tools? First, we're going to be ending really fast this live, but for new dispatchers, I want you to learn this, right? All of you know that is organizing USA by zones. And we are starting what? Z0, Z0, Z1. So what is this? Northeast, right? Then we go into Z2. So Mid-Atlantic and South, right? Southeast, Z4, Z5, Z6, Midwest, right? Then we have Southwest. Then we have Mountains, Z8. Then we have Z9 West Coast, right? Easy. Do you need to know by regions? Do you need to know by zones for that? Because when you're going to be posting, do you see how easy it was? Instead of me posting Illinois, Missouri, Kansas, Nebraska, Iowa, Wisconsin, Minnesota, I can do what? I can post Z6, right? Z4 if I want to stay here. For example, I decided I only need Minnesota, Wisconsin, and Iowa. I don't want to put Z5, all of it. So what am I going to do? I am going to add it, and I am going to put, let's say, Z6, and I'm only going to put Minnesota and Wisconsin. So you can combine zone and state. Now I say, so see, I have Z6, all the states in Z6, which is Nebraska, Kansas, Missouri, but I only want Minnesota and Wisconsin. That's very easy to do, right? So you guys do need to learn this, which states belong, and please, I am begging you, learn the abbreviation of the state, especially all the states. We started with M, right? All students having a hard time. Minnesota, Michigan, Maine, Missouri, right? Please, you need to know, because you think that you are posting Minnesota, but actually you posted Michigan or Maine, right? So make sure that all the states starting with M, you need to go over them maybe a few times. What other things you really need to pay attention? Key market areas in each state. So if you really look, let's say, if you look in Kentucky, you have Bowling Green Market, Charleston, Evansville, Huntington, Knoxville, Lavington, Louisville Market. Why that would make those as a key market? Very simple, because that's where we have production. That's where we have all the distribution centers. That's where we have people living. So this is your key market. That means if you go in close to Bowling Green, Kentucky, you will find a load, right? Because this is something which is already described to you as key market area. So for all my students for November and whoever in the class right now, please, open this bag and start learning all this. What else can we do here? Well, we always can check what's going on with market. So let's see, do we have any changes? Well, look, we're still strong, right? Drive and all loaded miles are 286. Flatbeds, stab decks, 307. And the strongest is reefer, right? And what are they telling us? You can even read this, right? That what's going on? Well, season's coming up, right? Our holiday season's coming up. So we actually have been seeing spot market, right? Look at this. If you click on drive-in, right? Let's click on drive-in. There's the map. This is a map for you. 308, 264, 273, 308. This is national rates for drive-in. If you want to just look at the map for flatbeds, you can see the prices right here. So again, by region, right? So does it make sense for you to start your day by seeing what's going on? Yes, but this is monthly changes, right? So this is monthly updates, right? This is our reefer, right? And then you can go more in details. You can compare the low to ratio. So please start using this. But if you are new and you have no clue how much you should ask or how much you should pay, at least in the beginning, use quick rate search. So here is quick rate search exactly for the type, and you can choose van, flatbed, or reefer. So let's say you have the van somewhere in Minneapolis, right? And you're talking about the load which goes to Oklahoma City. You are calling the first time. They are throwing the decision-making in your corner. They are asking, well, Vivi, how much do you want? How much do you want? Well, you need to make sure you at least check what have been happening, what, for the last 15 days. So they are telling you that it have been around $2,376 for this lane. Are you going to just settle for that, or are you going to ask for more? Well, hopefully you're going to ask for more, right? Any questions today? I can answer. We still have 5-10 minutes. And again, guys, our next class is starting on November 13th. You need at least 10 days to get ready. Make sure you follow us on Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, TikTok. And of course, if you're still looking to sign up for that, make sure you use our code to get the free months. Let's see. Helps the driver gets deliverance on night, then have full hours on Monday. Okay, helps if the driver gets to delivery on Sunday night, then have full hours on Monday. If you are talking, Carl, about restart, if you are delivering on Sunday night, you're not going to have restart already on Monday, because remember, how many hours do we need? 34 hours to do restart. So if you are delivering on Sunday night, let's say 10 p.m., you're done delivering. 10 p.m. on Sunday night till 10 p.m. on Monday will be what? 24 hours. Plus, you need another 10 hours. So early, early morning on Tuesday, you can start driving. I am new in the business. I need help. And again, everybody who is new in the business, you need to get basic knowledge. You need to know terminology. You need to know how to use load boards. You need to know how to do setups. You need to know how to negotiate. So lots of people say, well, learn by yourself. Yes, you can do it. It's going to take you a while. You're going to be practicing on carriers, which is not fair. So it doesn't matter where you take training, but make sure you get the training. Okay. And Do you recommend applying to the woman-owned certification? Starts up to you. There is some process. You have to follow the rules. Personally, me, in trucking, not that easy to get. It's easy to get, but you know what? I'll talk to you privately and you'll see that. Probably that's not something you're really going to do in trucking. But if you are only a dispatch service, yes, you should do that. Okay. And how does it help? It helps you with taxes. So it helps you with some breakdown on taxes. And I can send you the link and you can read what is involved to get that certification. This is just a process of getting extra certification, but it helps you with getting maybe loads, because if you're a woman's own business, they should give you choice first, for especially if it's a federal contracts or military contracts, you are first in line. What is this? What's going to happen with the market in a winter season? Is there any specific things that need to know as a dispatcher by working in the winter season? Well, we're going to see a few different things, right? We're going to see spot market, because when we have in snowstorms, usually the prices increase because most of the drivers do not want to risk their life. Plus, a lot of drivers are taking break in the winter time. So we have shortage on capacity, but since market have been really strong, I don't think anybody's going to be taking breaks because everybody just wants to make money. So spot market due to weather, but also spot market due to holidays. So you need to pay attention to the roads, interstate, intrastate, especially if you are going through the winter states. When we're talking about Wyoming, when we're talking about Utah, when we're talking about Colorado, but also Illinois, Minnesota, upstate Wisconsin, North Dakota, make sure when you look at the map, you understand realistically, does truck even go through some national reserve? No, make sure you learn, guys, interstate, intrastate, and also trucking roads, right? Trucks do not go to the certain areas. So you need to make sure to use professional maps. PC Miler or most of the softwares, they actually include PC Miler or any other professional maps. Google Maps is not really for professional dispatching because you need to know the bridges, you need to know the routes. In the pets, what are you carrying, right? If you're a hazmat carrier or you have oversize, you need to know way more than just looking at Google Maps. Even calculating the HOS. Google Maps is not the best idea to look at Google Maps and calculate HOS, right? Because you have to remember that we are trucks. Please, I need to talk to you privately about how to start my dispatch business. Well, guys, we offer personal consultation. You can book 1 hour with me and you can ask me questions privately or not privately. Before you open any dispatch business, you need to know how to dispatch yourself. So basic knowledge is the must. What else? Let me see other comments. Any other questions? Because guys, we gonna be done. So again, I want to make sure that you understand that knowing terminology is important. Understanding how the regulation works is important. What is MC? What is a USDOT? What is ICC? What is intrastate? What is interstate? What is a common carrier? What is a contract carrier? What is a dry van? What is a reefer? What is a vented van, standard van, or heated van? What is a van with a lift gate? What is a reefer with a team? What is a e-track? What is a tracking? What is a micro tracking, right? What is securement of the load? What is a cargo liability? What is a primary liability? What is a general liability? What is this occupational insurance? What does it mean worker compensation? Do you need it or not? And what does it mean to be a dispatcher? It's a lots and lots of questions to be answered before you guys can pick up that phone and promise somebody, hi, how much are you going to pay me for dispatching trucks, right? Well, first, you need to know what you are doing, guys, right? Again, if you guys have no questions, we're going to be finishing today. I'll see some of my students on Saturday and Sunday. We have finished up our safety class, our dispatch class, and our November class is almost full. We only have 5 spots left. So if you're really considering to join us, make sure you sign up. And again, where are you guys going to go? You go to our website, learndispatchtoday.com, right? And that's where you can register. All our registration for dispatch training, tracking safety and compliance, EFTON calculation. We also going to have how to open tracking company webinar. So this is coming up on November 21st. Make sure if you really want to learn how to do it correct before you guys go on a stop spending that money, sign up. It's $199. It's 3 hours where we're going to go step by step. What to do, how to do it. You don't have to pay no one to open UMC. You don't have to pay nobody to tell you how to do this. You can learn it. You're going to get all the links, and you need to understand this process anyway if you want to succeed, right? Also, you have personal consultation. For so people who wants to talk privately to me, that's what you can do. We can help you out with your business plan, with staying compliant. And if you have any other questions, I have a lot of students who do take personal consultation because they want to improve. Remember also mentorship for our students and outside of our classes. We have monthly subscription, $69 for our students. If you never took our class, it's $199 a month. And of course, our partners, if you are looking for that, make sure you use our links because you can get free months. If you are looking for good logbook service, we partner up with GPS Tab. If you're looking for TMS, tracking management software, I love to use UTAG. What else we have? We have a lot of different things. We have factoring. As many of you know, I am RTS agent. So if you are looking to start factoring, please reach out to me. Our services, of course, we have the full dispatch service. So we help you with first opening tracking companies. But again, guys, I don't want you to come and pay me. I want you to learn how to do it with that webinar and do it yourself. Stop paying. But if you are too busy or you're not sure, or maybe you still want to reinsure, that's what you can do. We have dispatch services. We have factoring fuel discounts. So, and of course, we have a bunch of our reviews, our students. We've been doing very well. And here we are. And many of you know, here is our YouTube channel. We have lots and lots of videos, right? And most of them, if you watch, you're going to learn lots of things. So thanks again for supporting us. A little bit of blind shipments. Oh, Sasha Phil, can you, Alex, tell a little bit about blind shipment? How does it really work? So, Sasha, I can tell you this. Sasha Filippo, I have a really good video in our a playlist, which the name of it is How to Handle Blind Shipments. I go the full hour in explanation what to do, how to do, what is a blind shipment, how to handle it as a dispatcher, as a driver. So please watch it. It's already there. It's already been done. It's pretty good explanation. If you still have questions, you can subscribe to my channel and ask me, and I will try to get back to you ASAP. But I believe after watching that video, you will be okay. Again, blind shipment, it's different than double brokerage. That's the only thing I want to stress out. Blind shipment, it's when consignee or shipper, or they don't want to know who is really sending that product, where it's coming from. So that's what means blind. You're closing your eyes. You go pick up in Miami And for example, Coyote tells you, we're going to pick up in Miami. But when your driver check-ins in Miami, he cannot tell them that the load is going to Los Angeles. He has to tell them that he's picking up load to go to Chicago. Why? Because I am a third party in Chicago. I am buying something in Florida and I am sending to California. I don't want to bring it to Chicago and then ship it, but I don't want people in Florida and people in California know where is it coming. So I am in the middle. So that's what blind shipment is. So your driver goes, checks in, tells the shipper that I am going to Chicago. The moment he gets out, he needs to get a new set of bills, right? Where he, when he's going to go to California, he has to check in with a new set of bills, which is going to say that this shipment came from Chicago. So that's why you need to pay attention. The driver understands what he has to do. You as a dispatcher have to understand that it's going to be extra stop. It's going to be extra paperwork. So you're going to have a dummy BOL. You're going to have a real BOL. In the end of all of this, you need both BOLs to get paid. So you just need to know the process of this. This is not illegal. This is blind shipment. Are you going to charge Coyote or TQL or CH Robinson extra for this? Yes, because extra things involved for your driver, for you, right? Of course. So if it's a blind shipment, here's your negotiation. Well, you need extra $300-$400 because your drivers need to stop. He needs to print a new set. He needs to really listen to instruction. Is that worth money? Of course. Who does it for free? Nobody works for free. So that's blind shipment. What about double brokering? Well, I had a student, right, who've been asking me, can we book the loads under OMC because somebody is having a hard time getting loads because of their safety score or maybe they missed some paperwork. So you think, okay, I am going to help them out. You book in the loads on UMC. Their truck is taking load from A to B, from Chicago to Memphis. This is double brokering. Double brokering is illegal. As a carrier, you cannot book loads under your MC and give it to somebody else to deliver this load. This is double brokering. This is illegal. So please do not mistake blind shipment and double brokerage. Blind shipment is legal, extra paperwork involved. Double brokering is illegal. So if you want to lose your company, go ahead and keep double brokering, right? What is an average days owner operator like to stay on the road? Well, it depends on every owner operator. It depends, again, if he has a family, which area he lives. For example, people who live in Miami, right? It's really hard to get good paying loads from Miami. So usually they don't want to go every weekend to Miami because it's hard to get out. They don't want to lose 2-3 days to get out to the good area. So they would stay on the road for 3 weeks. And most of the smart drivers, they will fly. They would leave their truck, let's say, in Chicago, Indiana, maybe to do some maintenance, and they would just fly and come back. People who live in a central, let's say, in Midwest, and they have family and they want to come back home every weekend, they start on Monday and they already Friday night at home, right? It depends, of course, on their dispatcher. This is a teamwork, right? So you as a dispatcher gonna ask your driver 3 questions. First, how are you, right? You need to know the name of your driver. You need to know his phone number. You need to know where his hometown is, how often he wants to be home. If by any chance you cannot bring him home for his restart or his break, what other city he would like to be or state, right? Maybe he has family in other region. Maybe he has friends. Do you need to know this? Yes. You're going to ask about his equipment, his truck, his trailer. You're going to ask him about his habits. We have drivers who only like to drive at night. So if you have driver who likes to drive at night, well, maybe your pickup and delivery, you need to make sure that that's going to work with your HOS. hours of service, right? We have drivers who only stayed regional. We have drivers who love to go west to coast because they don't want to deal with pickup delivery, pickup delivery, pickup delivery. No, they want to pick up load in Chicago. They want to go all the way to Seattle. So they are not doing pickup delivery every day because it's not that easy. But then we have drivers who love short loads and they don't mind picking up delivering. Everybody is different. But as a dispatcher, you need to know your driver. What is he looking for? And also, is he a company driver? Are you looking for miles or he's an owner operator and you need to concentrate on growth? Because why would you book the load just to give him 500 miles, let's say for $3 per mile, when you get him load for 300 miles and it's paying $5 per mile? So in the end of the day, his profit is even more and he's not killing his equipment, right? And guys, it all comes with some practice, some knowledge, but you and a driver have to be a team. The only thing which I always against is you asking your driver every day, should I book this load? Should I not book this load? Are you going to take this load or you're not going to? Guys, you're never going to succeed. Both of you. Both of you not going to succeed because driver does not see what's going on. By the time you call driver, by the time driver is going to think about it, what's going to happen? Most of the time, that load is going to be covered. Learn to make decisions. Because that's why you are a dispatcher. This is your job to book the load, know what you're going to do with him next day, know when to bring him back, know what the market's doing. This is your job as a dispatcher. If you just post in the truck and making 20, 30 phone calls back and forth to your drivers, you're not a dispatcher. You are simply secretary who cannot make decisions, or you are desperate dispatchers. And as many of you know, that's what we're fighting against, right? That's why we have 4,000 subscribers. That's why we have students in our classes, because we want to become pro dispatchers. We want to make sure that our carriers are still profitable, right? And we want to make sure that they trust us to do our job. And to get to this level, you need to have foundation. You need to improve every day. You need to go with markets. You need to go with industry. You need to go with technology. You need to listen to some people who've been doing it for a while or people who are doing it every day. But in the end of the day, it's up to you to become the pro dispatcher. It's only up to you to invest your time in, and it's only up to you to do that extra step, to make that extra phone call, to check extra time on the HOS before you book. It's up to you to build the relationship, right? It's up to you to give updates to the brokers. It's up to you to be a team with a dispatcher, and it's up to you how you want to succeed. When people asking me, how long is it gonna take me to find a carrier? Well, guys, it's up to you. How many phone calls are you doing, right? How many phone calls are you doing every day? How many people are you reaching out? How are you reaching out? Did you make the flyers? Did you create your website? Do you have your page? Do you have anything? Or you only have a script? I am going to be your dispatcher. I'm going to charge you 7%, blah, 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 blah. Do you even know what you're talking about? That's why this is a business. You are independent dispatcher treated as a business. And any business takes what? It takes some investment, right? So you invest in your knowledge. You invest in maybe some videos, or maybe you invest in making your page better. You invest your time in better phone, maybe extra softwares, right? Because you want to be professional dispatcher. So why not to subscribe to the better subscription of PowerDebt? Why not to have a better phone connection? Why not to have maybe extra apps? That's what it takes to be a businessman, right? any business, doesn't matter what business. So investment first, then knowledge, but then improving, every day improving, right? If you made a mistake, this is not the end of the world. We all make mistakes, but making sure that you don't do the same mistakes, right? Learning those HOS, understanding the drivers, knowing the commodities, right? I don't know what's beeping all the time, but that's what it takes. Oh, I think people signing up for the classes. Okay, yeah. Well, we just had 3 students sign up because I get notifications on my phone. I guess we only have 2 spots available for November because the 3 spots were taken right now. But in the end of the day, guys, I want to tell you, anything is possible if you put your mind into it. I love you all, and you can reach out to me anytime. I usually respond. Make sure you like our videos. Make sure you subscribe. Some people ask me, do we have to pay to watch your videos? No, guys, we still giving them for free, but we do have membership, $399 a month. If you want to support our mission, you're welcome to do so. If not, this is okay as well, because hopefully with my expertise and me doing this every day, I can just help you to start this or maybe improve. I love you. See you soon. And don't forget to share us on different platforms. And I'm saying goodbye.